When we're studying a big set of data, there are often two main properties that we're interested in: where the center or the average value of the set is, and how spread out the data is. In this video, we're going to talk about different measures of center or different types of averages for a data set. The most common measure of center, or what we refer to when we typically use the word average, is called the mean of a data set. If we want to find the mean of this set of data over here, what we do is we add all of the values together and divide that result by the number of data values. In this case, we had 7 values, so we're going to divide by 7. I'm getting 131 divided by 7, which is approximately 18.7. That is the mean for this set of data. Now for some notation. If this mean that we found is the mean of a sample, then we call this mean X with a little bar on top of it. If instead this data was actually a population, then we would have just found a population mean, and that has a different symbol. That is a Greek letter mu. But typically when we're calculating a mean on our own, we are calculating a sample mean. And to do that, we add up all of our data values. A notation for that is writing this symbol here, which means sum of all of your data values. Again, this symbol here means sum, and it's actually a Greek sigma. So this numerator here means that we're adding up all of our data values, and then we're going to divide by the number of data values, which we typically call n. So that right there is some fancy notation for calculating a sample mean. But something that you'll notice about this mean that we found here, 18.7, is that it's actually larger than every single data value in this set except for one. This last data value of 50 is really altering our mean value. So in some sense, this 18.7 doesn't really do a good job of representing the center value of this data. So there are going to be some cases when you have a set of data, and this might be one of them, where you're more interested in a different measure of center. You might instead be interested in what we call the median. And if you have a set of data that is ordered from smallest value to largest value, what the median is the literal physical center value of that set of data. If we want to find the middle value of a set of data, we can just start crossing data values off from either side of the set until we get to the middle. The median of this set of data is then 14. Okay, so far we've talked about the mean and the median. Our third measure of center for a data set is called the mode. And a mode is the most frequently occurring value in a data set. You'll notice in this data set that the value 12 appears twice, and every other data value just appears once. So our mode for this set of data is 12. If every data value in a set just appears once, then we say that we have no mode. If two data values appear most frequently, say if we had two 12s and two 14s in this data set, then we would have two modes. Okay, there's one more measure of center we should talk about. It is called the midrange. And the midrange is the halfway point between the largest value and the smallest value in a set. So for this set of data, our midrange is going to be 9 plus 50 divided by 2. That's 29.5. And that is the halfway point between the lowest value and the largest value in our data set. Let's find all of those measures of center for this data set and see what complications we run into. First, let's find our mean. Again, to find the mean, we sum all of our data values together and we divide by the total number of data values. I'm counting 10 data values total. I'm getting 106 for our sum. We divide that by 10, we get 10.6 as our mean. If we want our median, notice first that our data set is ordered from smallest to largest. Now we can start crossing off values on the outside, working towards the middle value of this data set. And you'll notice that there are actually two values in the middle of our data set. If this happens, when we're finding a median, what you can do is just take the average of those two values. In other words, we can take 9 plus 11 and divide by 2. That's 20 divided by 2, which is 10. Next, we can find a mode, and the mode is the most frequently occurring data value. In this case, 7 appears twice in our set, and 9 appears twice in our set. So we have two modes. We have a mode of 7 and a mode of 9. This set is bimodal. And finally, we can find the midrange for our data set. The midrange is the smallest value plus the largest value divided by 2. I'm getting 24 over 2, which is 12. Let's take a look at a couple of example problems. We're told that our mean quiz score out of 8 quizzes is 78%. We want to find the total of all of the quiz scores combined. Let's take a look at the formula for our mean. We are told that our mean is 78%, and we're told that the total number of quizzes is 8, and we're asked to find the sum of all of the quiz scores combined. So if we want to find the sum of all of our quiz scores combined, all we have to do with this equation is multiply both sides of it by 8. We multiply this side by 8, those 8s on the right side are going to cancel, and we just get the sum of all of our quiz scores. If we multiply the left side by 8, we get 8 times 78, which I'm getting is 624. That is the answer to this problem. We can check ourselves here. We just decided that the total of all of our quiz scores combined was 624. We knew that there were 8 quizzes, and plugging that into my calculator gives that the mean score of those 8 quizzes is then 78, so this checks out. Let's take a look at another example problem for mean. Alex has a mean test score of 82% for their first 4 tests. What score does Alex need to get on the 5th test to keep an average of 80%? Well, typically when we use the word average in English, we're talking about a mean. And again, our formula for mean is the sum of all of our data values, in this case, all of our test scores, divided by the number of test scores. Well, what we're given is that Alex's mean for his first 4 test scores is an 82%. Again, that was 4 test scores, so that's an N of 4. What that information allows us to do is to find the sum for Alex's first 4 test scores. We can solve for that sum the same way we did in the previous problem. We can multiply both sides of the equation by 4, and that gives us that Alex's sum on the first 4 test scores was 328. Okay, that's good information to have because we need to calculate Alex's mean after 5 tests. So to find that mean, we would add up Alex's 5 test scores. Well, we know his first 4 test scores add up to 328, and we don't know Alex's 5th test score just yet, so we're going to call that X. Then to find Alex's mean, we're going to divide that total by the 5 test scores, and we know that Alex wants to keep an average of 80%. Now, to complete this problem, we need to solve for X. To solve for X in this formula, the first thing that we should do is multiply both sides of the equation by 5 to get rid of the 5 in the denominator on the left side. Those 5s on the left will cancel, and we'll be left with 328 plus X on the left, and 80 times 5 is 400 on the right. Now, to finish solving for X, what we need to do is subtract 328 from both sides of the equation. 400 minus 328 is 72. So what we just determined was Alex needs a 72 on their final test to maintain an average of 80% for their first 5 tests. Okay, I would say that that was a pretty tough problem, but we should move on. So far in this video, we've talked about measures of center, the mean, the median, the mode, the midrange. Those are all properties of a big set of data. The last thing we want to do in this video is talk about how do we measure the position of a single data value within a big set of data. One way we do this is with quartiles. What quartiles do is break a set of data into 4 pieces. Let's do it and see what that looks like. The first step is going to be to find the median of this data. Well, again, to find a median, what we do is we work our way towards our middle value. Of course, if our data wasn't ordered first, we would have to do that. And what we found here is that our median is 34. And in terms of quartiles, we're going to call this median value Q2, or the second quartile. What the median, or the second quartile, does is it breaks a big set of data right down the middle. The set of values below the median and the set of values above the median should be the same size. The next step in finding quartiles is to find the median of all of the data values below our second quartile. So we're going to find the median of all of these data values right here. Finding the median of these data values, we find that we have 2 middle values, 18 and 18. Well, their average is 18. That value that we find is going to be our first quartile, or Q1. Next, we're going to find the median of all of the data values above Q2. We are going to find the median of all of these data values up here. So let's do that really quickly. There are all the values above Q2 for this data set, and we're going to find the median. We found 2 middle values here, so we're going to average those 2. That means add them together and divide by 2. Doing that is giving me 43, and we're going to call that the third quartile, or Q3. Okay, so we found our 3 quartiles. Let's take a look and see what that means. Let's say we have all of our data here on a number line. We can put our 3 quartiles into that number line. You'll notice that those 3 quartiles divide all of our data into 4 pieces. We have our smallest data value down here, and our largest data value up here. And what we can say now that we found our quartiles for our data is that 25% of our data lies right in here, 25% of our data lies right in here, and we can make statements about our quartiles. For example, you can see from this graph here that 75% of our data is going to fall below the value 43, or the third quartile. Likewise, 25% of our data falls above Q3, and you can make several statements along those lines. Now, we were talking about measuring the position of a single data value within a set, and we decided that quartiles were one way to do that. Another way to do this is with percentiles. And percentiles just take this concept of quartiles a bit further. Instead of dividing dividing up our data into 4 equal pieces. Percentiles divide our data into 100 pieces. There you go, there's a demonstration of our data being broken up into 100 pieces. Over here is the 87th percentile. You may have seen percentiles when taking standardized tests. If you scored in the 87th percentile, what that means is approximately 87% of all scores fell below your score. And that also means that approximately 13% of all scores fell above your score. Okay, I think that's all you need to know about percentiles, so I'm going to call this video here, and I hope that helps you out, and I will see you in the next one.